All right, let me pause my music here. So welcome, my name's Kirby Matthews and we also have Tracy Sklad joining us. We are here to dive in today to how to eat an elephant and smart goal mapping. The idea here is to take business tools and proven metrics and apply it to our life and things that we're trying to accomplish. So as we go through, it may sound very business and techie because we're also trying to make sure we're exposing you to opportunities and experiences that you would get in a professional setting as you grow within your own personhood from middle school, high school, or wherever you're at in life today. But we'll also make sure that we can apply this to things and areas that you want to grow into or things that you're already doing well that you want to start to track and improve against. So again, as we dive in, the question here is, how do you eat an elephant? You can put some questions in the chat or comment in the chat if anybody wants to call it out, but it's a pretty easy answer. One bite at a time. So often we get so into our own heads and there's so much going on and we've got a million things on our task list. We've got school and we've got work, we've got sports, we've got friends, you know, it's a lot on our plates and we don't know where to start. And half of that challenge is how you break that down into an actionable way or how you figure out what's going on and get it out on paper. So again, hopefully some valuable tools we'll go through today. As we go forward, we're going to talk a little bit about a certain methodology called Lean and how it can help you think tactically about some of the areas of growth you want to dive into or some areas, again, that you want to emphasize within your life that you're already doing. We'll look at smart goal planning and then best practices, and then we'll have some time for Q&A at the end. So I don't think that we will need the full hour today, but we've got it if we want it to go through that detail. So what is Lean methodology? I know that sounds like it could be a million different things, but when you think of Lean, it's a collection of tools, techniques, and principles that improve efficiency. So it's the idea that you can map something out and do this planning up front to look at areas of growth, areas of pain points, areas of improvement by looking at certain principles and waste that have been identified as part of this process. And so waste is this underlying idea that eliminates anything that doesn't add value. So whether that's an example, right, of you're trying to plan something with your friends, maybe you're trying to plan a birthday party and it's that game of telephone, you're going between 12 different people trying to coordinate. How can you optimize that? Maybe it's putting a Google Docs together so that you can all correlate that information in one place. And that way, you know, it's just easier planning. Or what tools do you have available? There's apps now that help you, like Splitwise, where you can split a check between friends, between all the different costs of what people are paying for. So it's that idea of thinking smarter, not harder, where it's we're not cutting corners, but really it's how can I do something with the least effort possible? And we've got a lot on our plates. We're so busy. So it's how do we put that into all the other avenues of life? Tracy, I think you were going to make a comment. Was there anything you'd call out there?
Well, I was just going to say it's even something as simple as, right, there's sleep apps, there's food tracking apps, there's all these things that kind of help you understand where you're at. I think the idea of waste is like wasted effort and wasted energy. So trying to figure out, man, if I do this a different way, I'm going to get this much more time back, right? Time is the one thing we all need. And we'll talk a little bit more about how do you manage your time. So this is a great tool that Kirby's sharing around how do I put together, how do I get rid of waste? What's wasting my time and where could I be spending it better? So I think of it in terms of that, which, as she says, it could be relationships, family, exercise, self-care, schoolwork, athletics, hanging out with your friends, video games. I know my house is full of gamers and they always need time to game at night. So that's important for them. So they try not to waste time on other things to make time for the things that matter. So I think that's what we're going to get out of Lean today.
Yeah. And if you were in the previous session or whether you're not, you map out those things that are valuable to you. So you've got these different quadrants within your life, whether it's love, health, play, work, maybe you've got a few different that we're not calling out there, but it's how you prioritize and the things that you put intention and emphasize that are important to you. And it's getting rid of the noise and everything else in the background. So I think that's the biggest thing is, you know, there's all this pressure or perceived pressure of what we need to be doing based on where we're at in life. And it's really about cutting that noise and understanding what is important to you so that you can put that value and put your intention into that. And you get that back from the world. So again, Lean sounds like more of a businessy term. It started actually from Toyota from a Japanese concept, which had to do with the manufacturing process, which it was going to where the cars were made and understanding from the people that were doing the work what was going on so that they could make that process better. And it's been evolved and translated into this notion of just how to run businesses, but also it can be applied to just project management with your own life, your own exactly, you know, what we talked about with all those different avenues of life. And so it's funny, but again, just we don't know, you don't know what you don't know. And by being curious and by taking that 30,000 foot view and then taking bite size at a time and going into those trees and how you would break that down, that's what we'll get into a little bit more today. So there's some of the things that we'll get into with SMART goal planning, but we're looking for leading and lagging indicators. So visual representation is important when you're looking at lean methodology. And the first things first, and Tracy called it, is the way that you think. It's this growth mentality of how do I do this the most efficient way possible? How do I make sure I'm optimizing my time? And by thinking from that lens, you're the one that's in control. So you're able to then take control over that narrative versus your life kind of happening to you. And so you're writing it down, you're getting it out of your head onto paper and identifying metrics. So whether it's work, relationship, self-care, writing down what's that priority to you, and then aligning to the strengths. So we talked a little bit again in our last session about some of those things that you identify about yourself that you find empowering or that you like about yourself. Those are your superpowers. And if you haven't done that exercise, that's a really great way to identify within those little quadrants of your life, how you break that down between love, health, work, and play. What are those things that you value most? And those are the areas that you want to focus on because that's what's going to move the needle the most in your life. And so aligning to those strengths around you and using that for the greatest impact. And then again, keeping in mind that work-life balance, where it's not a matter of being, you know, measuring your worth on your productivity and this action plan is everything that you need to check off. It's also those softer things of having relationships with your friends and your family, or making sure you're carving out time to play video games. And just again, making time for the things that are important to you and having that balance and knowing when that ebb and flow needs to be taken into consideration. So the other thing, again, is we learned from the Japanese business model, listen and learn to those around you. There's always an opportunity to grow. So you may know one really great way to do it and someone else knows another great way to do it and you can find that best practice. So that's one of the other tools we'll get into outside of goal planning and creating an action list that you can take into your arsenal and tools of where you can use this to benefit your own planning. And then I think we mentioned it, but again, setting metrics. So setting a measurable, attainable goal and making sure it's something that is valuable to you. So if you're exercising or you're wanting to eat healthy or you're wanting to increase your level in that video game, what is that thing that you can do to exercise that muscle or that brain or that routine that would allow you to make those incremental steps? So again, we talk about lean and these are the five principles of lean, but also the eight different wastes. And so I think the biggest thing, and we already called out a few of them, so we're just trying to make this more of a prescriptive, simplified way of how you can approach a problem or an opportunity for growth. So identifying and defining the value, mapping out the process. So what is it today that you're doing? What could you be doing? And areas where you have that future state, that current state and that future state. So mapping it out, that visual representation, we called it out on the last slide, is super important to be able to look and measure success and also hold yourself accountable to areas where you do want to grow. If you are taking the time to map this out, those are things that allow you to be able to move that needle. Creating a smooth flow. So that current to future state, you're looking for areas of improvement. You're looking for areas where you can cut out waste and create fewer touch points. So again, we'll go through some of those, but you're continuously looking for opportunities for improvement. Once you get to that end state, you'll continue to look for opportunities on that side. So again, growth is the goal. It's that adage of practice makes perfect. No, practice makes progress. We always want to build on top of what we're doing, because if we don't, then we know that there's more to learn, right? There's always somewhere where we can turn and pivot.
Well, and if you just stop, Kirby, yeah, if please. I could just real quick, if you just to get on your practice makes progress, if you think about an athlete, an Olympic athlete, think, or any athlete, think about how many times they do those activities. and they practice and they practice and they practice and they do the repetitive motion because they're finding the waste. They're using lean. They're getting the wasted motion, the wasted energy out of it. And so I think it's great to realize, if you think about someone that does a job and their job is to be an athlete, maybe they're a world-class skier or they're a tennis player, they practice because it's progress, because it's never perfect. So our lives, I think we all hold this standard that we want to be perfect, but there is no such definition. And you'll find in your lives, you may be very focused on school right now and working through all your classes and you're really striving to get a high GPA, or maybe you want to be athletics, you want to be better. I mean, it's all about kind of putting those together to find where can you move time around and make that, as she talked about, a smooth flow so that you have more time to do the thing you want. But I think we often think of practice makes perfect, and there's no such perfect. That's what makes life so great. And Kirby said yesterday, you know, if we were all alike, what a boring world it would be. I think you said that the other day. It was great.
Yeah. No, it's so true, right? I mean, we can all add value differently, and that's what makes that puzzle piece of how the world works. And so it's a great reminder that not one person is the same, and your idea of perfect is going to be someone else's chaos, right? Where, you know, as you grow into what you want to do, you may think that you want to grow into that certain area, and you get into it and you realize, whoa, that's not me at all. And giving yourself the opportunity to pivot quick is also part of that lean principle, where it's like, if you're putting a measurement to it and you're understanding the areas where you're putting focus into, you'll quickly be able to see if it's not something you like or if it's not the trajectory where you want it to go. And you can quickly use those visual indicators to be able to pivot. Or maybe it's looking back and having that historical hindsight and saying, oh, okay, now that I've done it, I would have done it differently this time. And you can help someone else and show someone else the different way to do it. And that will help you so that that next journey you go into, whether it's a career or a different job, a different sports team, or, you know, what other pivotal things that you're moving into, you can apply those same strategies for what you learned from your previous experience. So that's that leading lagging indicators that we're calling out of. It's not just mapping out where you want to go. It's taking the time to slow down and look at the process of what you've done today and what can you learn from that as well. So I think we called out a few good examples, but how are you maximizing your time within your areas of focus? Are there areas where you would be able to apply this? I think is a great way to think about it. There's, I guess, a good example of this is if you are somebody that's got a lot on your plate, where you've got sports, school, work, you've got family, friends, you've got it all, right? What are those areas that you can optimize your time in and really map out that time management? That's only going to get that much more challenging as you go into college and you get things that continue to get added to your plate. So you have to have that lens of how you identify what's important to you and how you prioritize those things against each other. So that's where the overproduction or waiting, looking at those areas or opportunities for improvement. Can you have less motion time? Maybe it's that you're trying to get home before you start your homework. Could you do your homework at school before you get home so that you can dive into dinner and have that separation from work and school life? Or maybe it's that, you know, you're redoing it. You're taking notes before you're going and reading something, or wherever you feel like maybe you can look at it. It's just that lens to be curious and ask those questions without judgment of, are there areas of improvement? And these are those buckets that you can identify within either a process or a thought that you have and see where you can improve upon that. So the question is, I think, where can you apply that lens? Where can you think of areas where this would be impactful in your life? And we'll get into that a little bit more. But just to go one layer down on that SMART goal planning, we'll go into how you get that out of your head and onto paper. And we talked a little bit about it with the lean methodologies. But when you're doing an action plan specifically, it's how you are specific about what you want to do. So who, what, when, where, why, even if that plan is going to change, you get it written down on paper so that you have an opportunity to be accountable. And then how do you measure it? So if it's not something you can measure, maybe it's that you want to increase your knowledge on something, then maybe it's just a goal that you set that can be measured of, I want to read 2 books a month, and, or I want to make sure that I join a meetup once a month that allows me to talk about that with someone and have an outlet for that. So how can you measure that, what success looks like? And success is going to be different for everybody. So it's not about how you judge yourself or how you measure whether you're good or bad on what you're trying to achieve. It's just, where are those milestones and those checkpoints that you can put in place that allow you to say, oh, I'm on the right path, or nope, I need to pivot. This is something I could do different to improve, or this is a good stopping point. I don't want to go forward. And now I know, because I measured what I wanted to try. So it's that try, and we talked a little bit about that before, try and fail fast. Achievable. So again, we talked about how to eat an elephant one bite at a time. If you're thinking of big picture and it's overwhelming and you don't know where to start, think about how you break that down into an achievable bite-sized way. So how do you chunk that out, either linearly? So in time, these are the things I need to do step by step. Or maybe it's, I'm going to start first with my research, and then I'm going to go and start on marketing. Or maybe it's, I'm going to go and do informational interviews and find out about different job perspectives. So what are those things that you can do that allow you to start somewhere? Because then once you start, it's the game of add-on. You can start somewhere and start small as you need to. And once that feels comfortable, you can continue to add on to your plate of what task items or areas of focus, whatever that is. And you can hold yourself accountable until you feel comfortable, and then continue to add on. So you're just building and growing upon that knowledge and that foundation of tools that you have available to yourself. And you become that tool yourself. That's the biggest unused potential is unmet potential is yourself within this planning, and giving yourself enough credit to know that you can do hard things. Relevant. So we talked in the last session, and if you weren't there, about wabi-sabi, which is this notion of finding your purpose and finding things that are relevant. So when we're looking at areas where we can cut out waste, are there areas where you have overlap? Are there things that you're doing really well in a certain area that you could apply to another area? Maybe it's the way that you reach out to your friends and the way that you make time for them. You could do that for your parents, or maybe it's that you want to volunteer, but you don't know where to start. So it's, what are those areas where you can, you know, not duplicate your effort, but emphasize and leverage what you're already doing well in those areas that you want to grow through. And the last thing is time. So holding yourself accountable to a time, to a checkpoint, to a milestone that you reflect back and look and see if you've accomplished what you set out to do. If you didn't, what you can do differently. Again, taking the judgment out, but being curious and having that outsider view looking in, so that you can have an honest conversation. We're checking our egos at the door, because these are things that we want to accomplish for ourselves. So if we take ourselves, our emotion out of it, and we just think about what we're doing, and we're honest with what we're doing, and maybe why we're not putting emphasis on something, that's okay. That's, you know, maybe that's not what you have time for now, and that's okay. Listen to the direction of where you're wanting to spend your time. So again, the idea is how you think about how these lean principles can help you with your own life efficiencies, whether it's a goal you want to achieve. Please. Yeah. Tracy, go ahead.
I didn't mean to interrupt again. No. I just want to share, I've been putting some ideas in the chat, you know, places this might work for you, or things like kind of in general around time and using time and wasting it. I put like school, life, athletics, band, hobbies, your friends, sleep, et cetera. One of the things I was thinking of is maybe you want to learn a new language or a new sport or try a new hobby. So smart goaling would let you pick something specific. I want to learn a new language. I want to be able to order lunch in French. And so you learn that. That's your specific goal. And then you measure yourself, because you work on it week over week. And then maybe it's part of your, you know, what are your, the timetable, right? So all the smart pieces, you can pick something that simple. And maybe you have to learn a language as part of your schoolwork, or you're trying to learn how to play the flute or a musical instrument. You can use this as kind of a way to check yourself to see how you're doing. And it might be a way just to look at something in a new perspective. And you'll be shocked when you go, wow, I made this goal and I made it. It's such a good feel-good feeling. And I would make small goals instead of one big one, because small goals give you that sense of accomplishment that you did it, and then you go to that next step, and it gives you a little bit more excitement to go to the next step. Yes.
Yeah, it's that game of add-on, but for, you know, if you're not an organized person, or even if you are, it's satisfying when you cross something off your list and it gets you closer to that goal. And so it's kind of, whether you are or aren't, it's those little psychology tricks that help you to progress things as you need to. Is there an example, Tracy, that you would call out where you could use this in your world? I know, you know, we're all different ages and points in our lives, right? But more of a relevant?
I'll give you two, one about me and one about my kids. I have kids that are school age. And one of the things they struggle with is, how do I do all my schoolwork? How do I have time to game? How do I have time to do my athletics? How do I have time to do this? All these things. And they come up. And so we talked about thinking about it in sleep, right? Sleep is critical to all of us. So we think about things in terms of blocks. I have this many blocks. If there's 24 hours in a day, you have 24 blocks of time. And you need 8 to sleep. And you have 6 in school. So that's 14. That leaves me 10 more blocks of time in an hour chunk, which I can make it smaller. But you have to eat and you have to shower and you want to have time to do this. So we have our kids kind of think about things in terms of blocks, and it really helped them kind of visualize where they were just wasting time, which is a good thing if you know where you're doing it and you're kind of putting a block in to do that. I know for me, one of the things I have a tendency to do is I love to pack my days with lots of different types of activities, and then I forget to add enough time to sleep. So one of the things I had to work on is putting more blocks back on my sleep pile.
Scheduling rest.
Things that I've done.
Yes.
Scheduling sleep and rest and time just to be quiet. That's a hard one.
Yeah. And also I think the lens or the perception, right? Where it's like, it's not, I'm not productive during that hour. It's, I get to focus on myself. So I think it's also so important, the intention that you put into what you're doing as well. You brought up a really good example when you said the block scheduling, because I think back to when I was in college and there was, you know, my first semester, I didn't have a job and I didn't, you know, I had all my time in the world on my hands and I got worse grades than when I was more organized and had 2 jobs and an internship and a full school deck. And I still was able to be social because you are forced to be organized when you have that much on your plate. And there's, you know, it forces you to figure out what's important and what you need to spend time on, or you can't procrastinate because you know you scheduled this hour to do that homework. And if you don't get it done, you're going to be doing it after you get off work at 11 p.m. at night or whatever. So it just helps you so that you don't create pain for yourself later on. If you can get yourself in that organized way of, these are the things I want to prioritize. And it helps, you know, keep you on that path as things come up and you go, okay, where does that fit within that block scheduling? Or do I have to move something out? That's great. Okay, so we do have, if I can get this to work, great. So just a few things to call out on best practices, and then we have an exercise we'll jump off with. So you've heard a lot about what we talked about through measurable action and writing things down and having that iterative improvement. So you look at the areas of improvement. This is all forms of plan, do, check, and act. So again, as part of that lean methodology, it's building out a framework for continuous improvement, having that growth mentality, understanding, is there a process today that I'm already taking? If not, is there one that I can map out so that you can start to look at those areas for improvement? Building out how you report or how you check, that can look different for anybody. And again, these sound like businessy terms, but I think as we called out a few different examples, these are all things that you can apply to your own planning that you want to do around, you know, whatever you're trying to grow into. So identifying levels of details needed. So thank you, Tracy. Identifying levels of detail needed. So how can you map that out? And again, we talked about the SMART action planning. We'll go through another exercise here. We've got a bunch of other templates we can go through as well, but making things actionable. And again, just having that lens of, this is my starting point today. This is where I want to get to. If you make it to where you want to get to, having that question and that curiosity of, is there anything I could do differently? Is there anything I want to do differently? And then standardizing. So making sure that you're mapping out the things that help you achieve that, mapping out the standard work. So like Tracy said, the block scheduling, those are all really good examples, depending on what your goals are, of how you can use your arsenal of tools to achieve those goals. So we talked about different tools. We talked about SMART goal mapping. We've talked about action planning. A Bob Wow is the best of and worst of. And I think this is a really great way to look at when you look at those quadrants within your life of work, love, health, and play. When you look at areas that you're doing well in or areas that you want to grow into or improve upon, you can look at the best of, worst of, which is, why am I doing well in those areas? What are the tools or the the methodologies that I'm implementing in that area of my life that are allowing me to be successful? And could I do that in those other areas? Or the adverse of that, asking your question, if there's something that you're not putting intention or emphasis on, asking yourself, why is that? Are there things that I could be, that, you know, that are, that I could be changing? So that, that best of, worst of. We talked about it a little bit at the beginning, but asking for help, defining and telling people what you're doing and putting it out into the world so that you do get that help and you do get those questions back from the teams. A MISI is another form of an action plan, but it's really a process map of just, this is my starting point today. These are my different choices. So again, just a bunch of different tools, depending on what you're trying to solve for, you can kind of pick out of that arsenal of tools and templates that would allow you to start to action this out. So with that in mind, we've got one action activity that we're going to go through. And it's kind of an idea of, again, you look at what you want to start doing, what you want to stop doing, what you want to continue doing well. And this is an idea of how to get it out of your head and onto paper, because so often we just get so wrapped around or so too close to an issue or an area where we want to grow. And this allows us to take that step back and to be able to look at it in a holistic way. So on a piece of paper, we're going to give you 5 minutes. I want you to just take a knee-jerk reaction, right? Write down anything that you are worried about, that you are thinking about, anything that you want to accomplish. Get it out of your head and onto paper. So this is meant to just be a very quick exercise, not to be overthought, but just what are those things that are swirling around in your head that you've got all jumbled up that you would want to write down? You don't need to order them yet. We'll get to that. It's just get it out of your head and onto paper. So we'll give you 5 minutes, write down what you want to accomplish, anything you're stressed about, anything that makes you happy that you're doing right now. And you can kind of think about it in terms of start, stop, continue. What are those things you want to start doing? What are those things you want to stop doing? And what are those things you want to continue doing well? All right, we'll put some music on and give you a second. If you have any questions or if anybody's getting stuck, feel free to comment in the chat or ask any questions. We can help to hopefully unblock you. I'm doing it in the background myself, thinking of all the things I want to, my bucket list of items, if you will. Anybody else have gardening on theirs? We'll give you another minute. All right, I'll pause there for just a second. You may not have had time to finish. That's okay. We'll give you another minute. Love that, Anne. Thank you. Gardening, it's. I'm like, okay, what can I do to connect with the earth and be more grounded? And it sounds like it's something easy that I would have time to do or carve out, but it's kind of like what Tracy said, you want to make time and carve out those things for you to for do those things for self-care. So we'll give you another minute, but I did just want to stop and say the next thing that we're going to do once you've had a chance to write everything down is circle everything you have control over. So we'll give you another minute or so to go through that to finish jotting down any ideas you have. But once you've done that, take a moment, circle everything you have control over and cross out anything you don't. Maybe it's you're stressed about what's going on in the world. And that may be something you still have control over. So again, it depends on your perception. Maybe it's that you could reach out and give a stranger a nice compliment and brighten their day and put some positivity into the world and instead of adding to the negativity. So again, if there is something that you think you have the capacity to do, great. But take a few minutes. We'll let you finish your thoughts on any of those things that you've got jumbling around in your head. And then again, just take a few more minutes and circle the things you have control over and cross out those things that you don't. We've all got things that are coming up, right? There's some great ideas that are coming through the window, right? I just want to call out where, you know, maybe there's stuff going on with the climate. Maybe it's about taking tests. Maybe it's about wanting to learn that new language. Maybe it's about living in a foreign country or where you want to go to school or making a new friend or starting a new sport. So again, just some ideas as you're going through, not always to talk about the bad and the good, right? But how you identify that emotion to it, because nothing's good or bad, it just is. We're the ones that I associate that feeling to it. So get it out on paper, get it out of your head and give your head a break. Just get it out on paper. We'll give you one more minute. Call out on just sea life. And sometimes I think we hear so much about things that are going on in the world and you think, oh, I'm just one person. I can't do anything about it. So, you know, why do anything about it? Or, you know, it's too big of a problem. I don't know where I can contribute or where I could add value. And it's those little, like we talked about, how do you eat an elephant one task at a time? When there's those big world problems, it's if you don't have control over it, what do you have control over? Maybe it's the energy that you bring to an environment so that, you know, people feel comfortable. Maybe it's about reaching out and volunteering at a homeless shelter, or it's donating your time or volunteering, donating money if you have it. It's what is it that you have accessible, that you have time and a willingness to give that could help aid that situation? So I think those are great examples. We don't always have control over what's happening around us, but we do have control over how we show up. Maybe there's a bully. That's a good call out. Good one. Or you see somebody else being bullied and you don't have to engage or stoop to their level, but how do you deal with that? And it's having a plan of maybe it's mapping out things you can say or holding someone accountable or making them aware of how it impacts you. Again, it's not that you have control over their actions, but it's what do I have control over and how can I act differently to improve in that situation? So again, leading lagging indicators. It's not always about what you could be doing in the future. It could be, oh, I could have done this better in the past. And these are some other areas that I can do better next time. So no judgment. There's never any judgment, or we should try to not have judgment. That's human nature too on ourselves. That inner critic comes out sometimes, but having the opportunity to be curious. So perception can be everything. It's not always the carrot or the stick, right? Of we have the carrot, which is how do we incentivize ourselves? Or we have the stick, that inner critic of how we beat ourselves up. And if we can be more compassionate, we will have a much easier time of accomplishing our goals for ourselves, but also for others around us. So hopefully those are some good examples of areas that you're wanting to grow into. Let me stop my music here fully so we can jump into the next step. But the next step, now that you have your list and you've prioritized areas that you have control over, I think the catharticism of scratching out what you don't is really important, because you get it out of your head, you get it onto paper, and you say, oh, that's not something that I should be spending my time and energy on, because I don't have anything that I can contribute to that's going to change that situation. So I'm going to spend my time and energy on those things that do help move that needle. So the next step is prioritizing our list. We've got a lot of things going on. We've got a lot of things. What value do they hold over the other? So we found a way to do that by mapping out the lowest impact and the highest value. And this can be with things, again, that you want to start doing, that you want to stop doing, or that you want to continue doing well. So I'm going to go just to the next slide here. This is a good example, but you're going to draw on a piece of paper your little quadrant. So draw your X and your Y axis with a T or a cross in the middle. You're going to label it low and high and low, and that's going to be that low impact, high impact effort. So we'll give you a few minutes to write that out, and it can be, this is just for you, right? Nobody else is going to see this. So this is just for you to have that 30,000 foot view and to be able to take that holistic view in a more prescriptive way. You've written down those things that you said were important to you or that are worrying you. You've crossed out what you don't have control over. You've identified the things that you do have control over. So now we want to map them here. So what are those things that those are those quick wins or those low hanging fruit? What are those things that you could do with minimal effort that would still be something that would help you achieve your goal or help you work towards that next step? The next one is going to be major projects. So those are those major milestones. Maybe it's going to achieve a certain degree in college, or maybe it's that you want to move across the country to a different state, or, you know, some of those more bigger plans, those longer term plans. And then your low impact is going to be those fill-ins. And this is where we do need to be honest with ourselves a little bit. Where are we spending our time that's filling our time? Maybe it is some of that fluff because we are avoiding some of those bigger golf balls. You know, there's always opportunities where we can grow more. There's always more room, but we might not want to make that room. We may want to just take into account what we're doing today and optimize what we're doing today. So we're giving ourselves the opportunity to ask those questions, to be curious, and to take a step back and to see what that looks like. And then lastly, it's that thankless task. So what are those things that you're doing that maybe add value elsewhere, but not necessarily for yourself? And that's okay too, right? It's good to have those different areas in life. But again, that balance of understanding, am I giving too much out of my cup where I'm not filling my own cup up? So we'll give you an opportunity to fill this out. But a good call out in the chats was chores. So I would say, you know, chores, they depends on what that chore is. It's teaching you value. Maybe it's a quick win because you know that if you mow the lawn or pick up your room that you get to go hang out with your friends. Or maybe it's that you know it helps your mom out so that she can go and fix dinner, or so that your dad can go mow the lawn and or help your sister with their homework, so that, you know, where it's all about that family unit and those blocks of time and how you optimize. So it may be really easy for you to do, and it's got a high reward because it's a quick win with your family and it helps them out and it doesn't take you that much time. Or maybe it's that you've got a big test and you don't have time to do those chores, and that could be easily moved to later in the week. And now you understand why you do need to prioritize it that way, and you can communicate that instead of getting flustered or frustrated because you don't have enough time to do everything. Now you can communicate what you need to those around you. Maybe it's that you have big competitions or big science projects or a big homework assignment. Maybe it's a big paper. So again, it's what are those things that you have around you that you need to also take into account so that you can optimize and be successful at that bigger thing that you're trying to accomplish. Again, building out your time so that you can be successful, and taking into account that the other stuff is also important. It's not necessarily that those fill-ins aren't important, because it's the value that you assign to it. Maybe it's hanging out with your friends and it doesn't add value to your professional growth, but it adds value to your personal growth. So it's dependent on how you value those things, not how other people value them. I'm going to give you just a second to fill this out, and we'll draw on a few different parallels here. But if you have questions, as always, ask them in the chat, and we'll give you just a few minutes to take the time to do this. Again, you're focusing on the things that you have control over, that you want to do, that you are already doing, or that you want to stop doing.
You know I tried so long. Every time I thought I found it, I was wrong. I swear I...
Well, I'm just a lonesome dreamer, traveling down a dusty road. All I have is ambition in my hand and a heart full of hope. I can see tomorrow clearly, feel the future in my bones, and I'll never forget those words keep ringing in my head that mama said just before I left home. Love your life, love your life, live your dream, live your dream, do your best.
We'll give everybody just another minute. Hopefully you're able to map everything, and that's okay if you don't. It's okay if it doesn't exactly fit in that box. Just see where you would put it based on your perception of where you're at today. It doesn't need to be perfect. That's the whole point, is that practice makes progress, not perfection, right? We're just looking at where we're at today, where we value those things. That may change tomorrow. All right, hopefully you had a chance to map that in. Again, just to call out another few good examples of areas maybe that you can apply this, right? So your bigger goals would go here. These are your longer term things where it takes time and you need to map it out, but it's got that high reward. So high value, low effort, that's the ones you wanna do first. That's gonna have that biggest impact. And then the maybes are gonna be the things that have low effort, but high value. Things that are low effort, low value, just cut them out. And now you have that opportunity to say, these are things that aren't serving me well today. I'm going to set them aside for now. I'm going to give myself permission to take them off my plate. Maybe I'll come back to them at a later time. But for myself, if I were to go through this, an example would be wanting to get a certification for my job. Maybe it's something that I can't prioritize with my time right now, but I know that if I had the time to do it, it would increase my fulfillment at work. It would give me more money. It would maybe increase my job opportunities at a later date. So knowing that those are the benefits of what I could gain from that certificate, whatever that is, that's maybe that tell, that push I needed to then prioritize that. So for a little bit of effort, I can have a really high reward. So that's something that I'm going to put in that yes bucket. And then maybe it's, I'm trying to work out more and I'm trying to be healthy, not because I want to lose weight, but because I want to be healthier for myself. And I've not been doing that. I've been making up excuses because I didn't have time or because I instead wanted to watch a certain TV show. So I'm going to cut out that TV show so that I can carve out that hour for myself so that I can go walk. It's good for my mental health. It's good for my physical health. It allows me to quit another habit of that reward of watching TV. Instead, I'm going to get that reward from going and connecting with nature. So it can be something you want to accomplish, or it can be using it as something you want to cut out. But it's all just an opportunity to present ideas of how you can use tools to be able to move forward. So lastly, just to close out on some of the concepts and themes that we talked about, getting alignment, so agreeing to what it is that you want to track, having something that's measurable and time-bound, and doing that plan, do, check, act. So after you do that planning, you execute, and you give yourself an opportunity to look back at a holistic view of these are the things I did, what worked, what didn't, without that judgment, but from that lens of continuous improvement. It's setting yourself up for success by having visual management. So what are those leading and lagging indicators that I can use to measure success? What do I want to measure and put in place that would allow me to create milestones so that I'm creating those bite-sized steps of how I eat that elephant? It's how you standardize. So what's the consistency? If every time you look back at something and you're tracking some other piece of what success looks like, so you think, okay, I want to learn to run faster and I'm going to track my mile. And then the next time you go, oh, I'm going to track my heart rate. Those things aren't the same. They're not going to give you the same opportunity to identify how you've measured success. And they both might tell you that. So maybe it's that you need both. So again, making sure that you're identifying what that proper standardization needs to be that's going to allow you to succeed or to fail quickly. So it's that, how do you make it bite-sized enough so that you can look at those checkpoints and see with your measurements, is this something that's I should continue doing? Do I need to pivot the metric? Do I need to pivot my behavior? And it's that allowance of that standardization that allows you to make that quick change. And then failing fast, problem solving. So we talked about a lot of different tools and templates of action plans or process mapping, or putting together that matrix that we just looked at with the low impact, high value. There's so many different tools out there. So not all one tool fits all. So problem solving and identifying what you want to use in your arsenal of tools to be able to accomplish your goals will allow you to get there faster, and not assuming that you already know, taking the time to do that plan and to identify and to brainstorm what would work, and then try it, and then iterate and try again. So it's all about progress and not perfection. And that goal will continue to change. As you have goals that are important to you now, those goals will continue to evolve and either be built upon or change completely. So give yourself permission to be curious and to see where your planning can take you. I hope this was a useful session to be able to dive into a little bit more about how you get that chaos out of thoughts and onto paper. And if there are follow-up questions, happy to answer those in the chat. But otherwise, just want to really thank everybody for their time and their willingness to learn and be curious about themselves and how they can grow into their future. Thank you, team. Have a good rest of your day.
Thank you, Kirby.
Thank you, Kirby.
Cheers. Have a good day.
You too. Mm-hmm.